Children's Magical Guide in Norfolk and Stanton on the Lower East Side. We're outside the boundaries of the Garden District, which has about 45 community gardens. And we're in an area that has very few community gardens. There's one over on Rivington Street. There's really just a handful of them. There's a couple further downtown, but we've mapped them all, and there aren't that many in the community, so it's a real need.
Hi, I'm Ben Shepherd. I'm a volunteer with Time's Up New York, and in between the rubble and the garbage in New York City, we have a little bit of green space, a small amount of green space, patches, corners, and in vacant lots turned into gardens, and they're really precious for those of us that live in the city.
I think people don't realize how much work and struggle went into keeping these green spaces. You know, people come in now and they sit down with their coffee and they play with their kids, and they don't realize that there was so much marching, there was tree sitting, there was arrests.
10 years ago, a lot of activists fought very hard.
Nobody going to take Esperanza Grande. We have to fight.
It's important that people know the story of this garden. You know, it was part of our family.
This is Esperanza Community Garden, 15th of February on the year 2000.
We have a lot of children in 7th Street, and this is an activity garden.
Well, this garden was here since I was a little girl. I grew up picking grapes out the trees, running through with my cousin. It really destroyed my grandmother when they took it away from her.
We're here because we're taking this chance. We're sticking ourselves on the front lines because we think it's important to save the oxygen, the green space, the safe place for kids to get out of the streets, old people. We want to keep the green and the oxygen for the higher purpose.
You know what?
What happens when they fill in all the gardens? What happens then? Talk to me.
Well, I'm interviewing you for the police department, man. That's what this tape is for. So I think that you did a very good job in stating your cause. And I got to get out of here to get these guys some room to work.
Can I take a peek at this here?
Sure.
This is all in case of concrete that we had to break up. We got to take this off now.
Uh-huh.
You got themselves chained on the inside.
We called the lawyers, we did everything we could do to save the community gardens, and after the Esperanza struggle, we actually got a deal from the city to prevent the bulldozing of community gardens for a number of years. The deal that the city cut with Elliot Spitzer is ending this year, this September, which will give the city, basically this will give the city the lease to turn these gardens into development spaces, to sell these spaces off to developers. The best public spaces are well-used public spaces, and we're here to use these community gardens and enjoy them, and to sound the alarm that in September we could lose some of these spaces. So everyone needs to make some noise, call some friends, let them know the gardens are vulnerable again, and we need to shake it up. We need to call our politicos, and we need to let them know that we need to save all the community gardens in New York City. The city talks a lot about being a green city. We hear a lot about green space. Green. But it's green washing unless the city wants to preserve green spaces for people to enjoy.
Put up a parking lot. City has got to breathe. More gardens. More peas. New York City has got to breathe. More gardens. More peas. New York City has got to breathe.
My name is Azad.
And what is this?
This is a garden. This is the middle part of the garden. That's a treehouse. This guy named Roderick made it.
JK, how long is this garden?
This guy named Roderick made the garden.
Yeah.
Do you play here?
No, I work here.
You work here?
Really?
What do you do?
I help my mom, and I work here and help the garden. And now the treehouse is going to get invaded by veggies.
Yeah, still there.
Let's take those veggies to task.
This garden is actually marked as parkland, so it ain't going nowhere. This garden is here to stay. And it's a demonstration garden for rainwater catchment. And the wetlands kind of volunteered themselves. When they dug the hole and it rained, the rain sat in a in a puddle. And the puddle said, I want to be a wetland. So we lined it, and we had frogs and fish and turtles.
I came here in 1975 for a photograph right over there. We are on 4th Street, 5th Street, D, C. And I walked down 4th Street to take my first black and white photographs of this neighborhood. Then walked through this totally empty lot, which was rubble strewn. And I said, my God, this is like Berlin, 1946, 1947, where I grew up. Here I felt, well, maybe we can do something. And I built my first garden over there, Paraíso and Tranquilidad over there. These were all apartment buildings where we are, where we're standing right now. There were vibrant communities of tenement buildings filled and overfilled and with people. And where are they? Gone. And nobody can live here anymore. Most people who come here actually live outside the neighborhood and come to visit. They live in Brooklyn. Like Mayor Koch once said, if you don't like it over here, why don't you jump into the river and swim to Brooklyn? Then he came to a show in 2005, and it was actually pretty gracious and signed a photo, hooray, to the community, hooray, you won, because we're still here. We didn't swim, we stayed here, we will stay here. We have our trees here, we have our grass here, we have our roots here now. We have put them down. Hooray. You know, people said, well, don't you like this better? I said, yeah, but what cost? What cost? You know, what human cost? What social justice? Forget about it. If we hadn't done what we did with the gardens, which attracted a lot of people, still do, you know, we'd all be gone. This would not be here. You wouldn't be able to enjoy this. This would be annexed to Wall Street via the East River.
This particular place we're in now, La Plaza, has a long history. Again, this was La Plaza was here way back at the point of the occupation of Charas back in the 70s. Went through some changes, and it's been used for, at one point in the 80s, on the weekends, there were hundreds of peddlers in here. It was a flea market. This is, you know, it's public space and open space. These are phrases that denote a certain physical entity.
Right.
But really, what it are, they're spaces of freedom.
Yeah.
They're spaces where people can think freely and converse and, God forbid, hatch plans for, like, you know, pushing forward a movement for freedom and liberation and justice and so forth. So these open spaces are seen as threats, whether they're gardens, squat centers, social centers like Charas and others. They want to basically lock us out, keep us as atomized as possible, separated, so we can't come together and, you know, share our thoughts and our inspirations and plan to expand our movement.
Yeah, we definitely have, you know, starting with the early Earth celebrations, you know, that kind of painted. But then there's also definitely, like, this has become a hub for the radical fairy circuit.
Peter Kramer.
You've been so good to us through the years. Thank you very much. I'm always emailing you that all the time.
Let me squeeze your tomato.
Stop the developers, plant and grow. Stop the developers, plant and grow.
Great garden because one of the great historic gardeners in the history of the movement used to garden here, Francois Catalan. She actually used to run the bulldozer hotline. Her brilliance was that she recognized the radical power of a community garden, and it was one of the final organizing campaigns she was involved in, was fighting for the community gardens.
get involved with gardens? How did you get plugged into doing garden activism?
I randomly walked by the old info shop that was on Avenue B.
Yeah.
Blackout Books.
Yeah.
I saw a flyer for Les, the Lower East Side Collective. I thought it was really clever. I think Leslie Kaufman designed it.
Who's over there right now.
Yeah, over there. And it looked like it was like a fake moving sign. Moving left, go with left. Yeah. I thought it was cute. And I was like, radical leftist with a sense of humor. Like, that's
good. It's a good thing.
We need more
of that in this world.
So I just decided to show up to a meeting, and I liked everybody. I had just moved to the city. I didn't know a ton of people. And I had nothing but time on my hands. And then, so I gradually got involved, and I started to gravitate more. I tried to do a little of everything, but I gravitated a lot to like issues of public space. Charas El Bohío was a big rehearsal. Like a lot of people that I knew in theater use it as a rehearsal space.
Can you tell me about the day that Charas was auctioned? How you guys responded to that?
Yeah, that was
bless you.
Sorry, an auction at One Police Plaza, City Land auction.
Yeah,
they're auctioning tons of lots, gardens, a few vacant lots, but mostly gardens and Charas and a couple other community spaces. And a bunch of us had smuggled in live crickets. We ordered it from a pet supplier in mailing envelopes. And we had, it was really funny because we tried to camouflage ourselves as like real estate investors. But meanwhile, like the guys that were showing up to bid on real estate were not dressed up at all. Like
Seth Bookman says people didn't look like money in that moment.
So we wore like ties and we kind of stuck out like sore thumbs. But we got in with the crickets. They went through the metal detectors. And then at a given moment, we had a queue set up.
Yeah.
I don't remember exactly what it was, but I think it was like a certain lot number.
Yeah.
And then we dumped the crickets out. I saw the woman sitting next to me look kind of arty. Like she was So I was like, oh, she'll be cool. Like I didn't realize that she was going to have a visceral reaction to like a pile of bugs at her feet.
Yeah.
So she screamed and jumped up on a chair. It was like the commercial with like where they put dishwashing liquid in water and the oil dispersed. Like all of a sudden there's this huge crowd.
Yeah.
Like, there I was like completely exposed. And I was in the bathroom actually when we picked the spot. So I had the worst spot.
Oh!
And so I ran immediately into like the big like barrel chest of a plainclothes officer. You know, it was just like boom, like his chest was like eye level to me. And so I took I just put up my hands. I was like, here you go. Well,
Tim Becker recalls when he was going through the system, you guys were locked in a closet for a little while.
Yeah.
And he said that Jason had crickets coming out of his pocket.
Yeah.
And he said, I'm getting arrested with the Three Stooges here. I can't ever say I'm innocent now. But Jason, thank you for walking us around the garden today.
Oh,
man.
Sure. Yeah,
I really, really appreciate it. Thank you, brother.
Great. Thanks for coming.
Arts and theater, man. Arts and theater and gardens. That's what it's all about.
Great.
Everyone, welcome! Welcome to the Paul Revere ride!
So he wants to get people out in advance at these heavy intersections.
Thank you, man. Thank you.
All right.
We'll do our best. We're doing our best.
What's going on?
I'm getting stressed out. I've gotten 15 calls from the cops all day. These guys are breathing down my neck. And I'm trying to do this Paul Revere ride. And they want to control every inch of it. We have a very, very simple message. The city needs to preserve the community gardens.
Yes.
We don't need to transfer the gardens. We don't need to do a new policy for the gardens. We need to preserve the community gardens.
Here, here. So what's our route here?
We're gonna start down B to Children's Magical.
Yeah.
Well, we gotta discuss the route you wanna take, so that we wanna change it at the end. That's where I'm asking. So.
And we're out here right now to let everyone know on September 17th, 2010, the Spitzer Agreement, which basically preserved the community gardens, ends. The city's established a new set of park rules, which sets up a mechanism for the gardens to be transferred for redevelopment, one by one. Do we want to see the gardens bulldozed?
No!
No. So let everyone in the neighborhoods know the bulldozers are coming.
Been there for over 20 years. If they got rid of that garden, I would break down in tears. I don't even think I could go on. It's my happy place.
Do we want to come in and dance on the meadow? So welcome to our garden of squash and tomatoes and chickens and fish and turtles.
And neighbors
and a hawk and many languages, Bulgarian, Spanish, you name it.
Where are you going now? To this park right here?
We're going to the plaza. We told you guys that.
Right, the plaza, right, Dan?
Yeah, right there.
Here's the word!
Go right over there.
Your community gardens are at risk.
Save the gardens! Save the gardens!
Save our community gardens!
Have a nice evening.
Bye. Good night.
Take care, guys.
My people.
Yeah, where's the house?
It's on the right side, right?
Everybody stay on the right. They're gonna rugby tackle us.
Just keep riding.
Here they come.
Oh. Okay, we're gonna ride right past them. Do not stop, whatever you do.
Okay, go.
Right. That's right.
Right.
To the side.
Police are keeping us from saving the community garden. Save the gardens!
So we have this offering to the mayor from the community gardens.
We're just trying to say to Mayor Bloomberg, you have talked a great deal about the importance of a green city. So we're here to say to you, Mayor Bloomberg, this could be your legacy. You could be our hero. Do the right thing, Mayor Bloomberg. Please, please, please preserve the community gardens. Make the gardens available for our children's children. It's the hottest summer on record. Let's make sure that the city has green spaces for us all to enjoy in the future to come. We've taken so many hits. These are flowers from the Children's Magical Garden in the Lower East Side, an endangered community garden which could be bulldozed, a place where my children, Scarlett and Dodie, have both played in the dirt instead of the asphalt, and they've grown up and they've connected with people of all walks of life here. If we don't have these community gardens, my kids are never gonna have that kind of interaction with different kinds of New Yorkers. So we're offering these flowers for you, Mayor Bloomberg. Please accept these flowers and save all the community gardens. You can do this with a pen. Save the gardens, Mayor Bloomberg. Do the right thing. Save the gardens!
Save the gardens!
Take care, guys. Save the gardens! Save the gardens! Save the gardens!
Have a good night, everyone.
Sunflower Jess!
Now you can be put on hold for an indefinite period of time until they're done.
Yeah! Way to go, Jess!
More gardens, less buildings!
Yeah, more gardens, less buildings, baby!
More gardens, less buildings!
Yeah,
more
baby!
Food, less buildings!
Good, Jess.
It's perfect!
What's up, guys? This is the spokesman I can talk to.
So the lieutenant has asked that we leave the lawn in 2 minutes or face some sort of repercussions. So that's up to everybody.
Yeah, baby.
All right.
Oh my God! Oh my God! Oh my God!
You know, community gardens are in the inner cities, and as you know, inner cities are rough environments for people in general and for young people in particular. It's a toxic environment for our young people. The climate of poverty, the climate of unemployment. Our community gardens allow young people to be productively engaged and to be employed in a civically responsible way, learning how to be stewards of the environment, learning how to reclaim their community, learning how to grow vegetables, learning about life skills such as nutrition. We're doing something in our community where we're fixing our community. And we're saying to the city, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. We have put blood, sweat, and tears into reclaiming these abandoned lots from the crack vials, from the heroin syringes. We have taken the initiative to clean out the garbage and make these spaces real safe, where all people can come and feel safe. We've stabilized our community. We've reduced crime in our community. We believe in ourselves. That's why we do this. We do this for ourselves and for the dignity of our community. That's why we're here, to preserve and calling for the preservation and protection of all community gardens.
What do we want?
Green Thumb, the Model T Garden in the Bronx, and I'm here to trying to save our garden because we grow a lot of vegetables, and the school uses the garden for classes during the day, and we plant vegetables and stuff for night, and what we don't eat, we give them to the people in the community.
More gardens now!
To do this by local law. We don't know the answer to that yet. The lawyers are researching that.
So the goal is to preserve all the gardens forever, though?
That is my goal.
All right!
Yeah. Yeah. So, but let me just be clear. We're working towards that. I can't 1,000% promise you we're going to get there. We're working as hard as we
can. But that's what we want to hear.
Right. Does anyone want to say anything since they can't get inside?
We're getting inside.
You want to say anything to the camera?
We're getting inside.
What do you think about not being able to get in there?
Well, everything takes time.
You must be a gardener.
I am.
I could tell by your patience.
I think it's really poor planning on all of your parts to not have capacity for more than, it looks like maybe 100 people in there. You really thought that only 100 people would show up for this?
I read the sign, it said 295 people. And I counted 230, we did another count, 228. We did another count, went at the max, 238. And the sign clearly says 295. You have no opinion of any? Public hearing, not being open to the public?
They went in on these empty lots where the buildings crumbled, removed the debris, and made community gardens. Brick by brick, seed by seed, my community built a community for its residents that included permanent open space. We need to, either through the rules or legislation, and I vow to go back to the city council to make sure that we create a pathway to permanency where our community gardens become permanent open space. Thank you.
There's hundreds of people outside right now not being allowed in. We should wait until they're all allowed in so we can all hear together.
Less hearings, more gardens! 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 Less hearings, more gardens!
We need the city to support creating more gardens. That's all we need.
right now. The city doesn't even have hearings to plan on transferring gardens out. We need to have more gardens today. It's a simple win for everyone. If the city was fully committed to reducing climate change, it would support community gardens, would support community networks, would support families, would support
disrupting the hearing. The next speaker is Mr. Donald Loggins. Is Mr. Loggins here? The next speaker is Mr. Garland Roberts.
The capacity is 295.
He's outside.
The next speaker is Captain Major Marion Sylvia Jordan Purcell.
They've been calling her name.
They've been calling my name, I hear. And we're with
she's
the
registered. They've called
garden
her name about six times.
She's with our group as well.
I just hope that we're able to keep our garden because it's so much, it's so important to our community to be healthy, to eat healthy at this time in our life. We must eat healthy to stay here on this earth. We must eat healthy. And I say that I'm doing the best. Look at me, and I'm trimming trim. Look at, he had to go down. And I said, no stomach, no nothing. I eat healthy.
Thank you.
How about you?
You eat healthy. How about too? You?
Hey, where'd those beets come from?
From the ground.
From
the garden.
From garden. At Flamboyant Garden in the Bronx. We got all kinds of vegetables. We have tomato, peppers, carrots, eggplants, okra. We have trees of apple, peaches, cherries, strawberries. And we have all kinds of things in there. We grow all kinds of vegetables in the garden.
If you go to any Whole Food store, organically grown beets, you pay $4.99, $6.99 a pound. You go to the store, you'll pay half that, but it's either chemically, toxically altered, genetically altered, you're gonna pay half. But if you support a community garden, grow it, you can get it for free, you can give it away, you can do all these wonderful things. Support community gardens today.
I've seen this place when it was at its worst, you know, until now, when, you know, it's more like family now. So this was really bad at one time. I was here when all the buildings burned down and it was like a sea of abandoned buildings and stuff like that.
This happened to be an underutilized parkland space, which was an ideal location because it was already public space, and there's adjacent to local schools who actually encouraged our involvement, approached us to do something for the local community. And the students, mostly from International High School and other student groups, built from scratch these garden beds and compost, and we grow food every year. Classes adopt a bed and they can grow whatever they want.
How long have you been involved in this park?
Since when I was little, since I was maybe like 8 or 9. Most of the time I would hang out here because like over here in the neighborhood, it was always like a lot of stuff going on. And then over here, it seemed like really safe and all right. Like it was the only place like I wouldn't get judged because I would always want to play my own stuff, play little kid games. I didn't want to play basketball, do all that extra stuff. So I would come here and it's always fun.
Hi, my name is Josh.
My name is Paris.
I remember when I was 8 and like, at first when I used to pass by here, it was basically completely empty. As I got older, I noticed they started doing more and more to just rebuild this area and to just keep it preserved in a way. They planted so many trees, and I remember when half these trees were like, they were really short and they grew and sprouted.
We used to have a tree over there that we used to climb, but it kind of got knocked over by the storm like 5 years ago.
It was over there, it was a big willow, and it grew, it was really tall. It was almost the size of a street lamp. That was our favorite tree. It was like the only tree you could climb that was sturdy.
Climbing.
So you guys would play together?
Yeah.
Yep. Been friends ever since. We was little, right? When I met you, I was 10.
Yeah, and I was 9.
Maybe 11.
And I'm gonna be 18 in 3 days, and he turned 19 today.
Yeah, I know.
There's, my favorite thing is was the teepee. We would always play inside the giant teepee. It was colossal.
I remember that.
And I mean, I don't even know how they set it up, because the thing is huge. Yeah, it's usually set up right around here.
There's always things going on here. Things are always changing here.
No matter what the season,
every weekend
there's always festivities.
There's always something going on, even during the week.
It was fun, and it was constructed, like you said. As opposed to doing something else or getting myself into trouble, I could just chill here and just do what I want and help out.
Uh-huh.
And the fresh cherries are good, too.
There's one of our six wells. Oh, this is the biggest one.
We've been working on a restoration project to daylight or uncover a buried waterway. Something like that has not been done in New York City yet. The Brook of Brook Avenue and Brook Park actually runs under here, and hopefully in a year or two we will have it restored with frogs and fish and turtles and everything.
I heard when I was younger that there used to be an actual brook flowing through it, which is why it got its name. If they could actually keep working on that, then I see that brook being one of the best things done for this community. So, I mean, when people see action, it gets them inspired, and hopefully it will bring people together and make them want to work to achieve things as great as a brook. I mean, it doesn't have to be a brook. It could be something as simple as an hour of community service. But I mean, as long as people see effort, maybe they'll want to try. That's the most important part.
Do you see that people will always try and keep this place growing?
Honestly, I do. I mean, if you look at Liam over there, like, little kid, I see him being here for a while because, I mean, that's around the age that we started coming here, and we fell in love with this place. I mean, we're still here. We come by as often as we can. I mean, as far as it goes, he's doing the same exact thing we used to do, so. There's always gonna be a generation that's gonna keep helping this place prosper. That's what I think.
I think once a person like tries once, I think they'll really like it. Cause I find it really relaxing for some reason. It's like when you're a teenager, you're so stressed out for no reason these days. And then when I come here, it's relaxed. It's like so quiet. It's like so different. It's like when you go over there, it's really loud. But then when you come over here, it's like, it's a whole different world. It's just so quiet, nice, relaxing.
We're at the chicken coop right now. You can see everybody. You can see lots of chickens. All these guys sing, bop, bop, bop.
Side like that. So either on its side, the main thing is just only this little top is out of the soil, and then all of the roots are going to come out of the top. Well, you want to do it in between the stakes. So that's perfect. Yep. Mm-hmm. That's great.
Well, that one isn't quite deep enough.
Can you bring me a pole over here, Scott?
Okay. One?
Thank you.
So let's see. Oh. You got one in your hand.
What's your name?
No.
Ella. Nice to meet you.
Or yeah.
Would you like to plant some eggplant?
Yeah.
I take the plant.
All right.
Pack the soil. So I plant it right next to it because it's gonna.
Okay. So let's see. Where's a good spot?
We kind of shake it.
Ooh, careful. But we try to keep it into the radio flag. And we're just gonna dump it into this one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. We need people to make sure it's
put
stable.
Put your hand in there.
There Scott, hold on. Scott, we need you to hold it.
Okay.
There you go.
All right.
All right.
Now, I don't need
everybody, and try to keep it in the wagon.
Yes. Yeah.
We'll do maybe like
one.
Can
I have a worm? I don't have a worm.
What do you think of holding the worm?
It's
a worm. Yeah.
All right. Wagon full of compost?
No boys are here.
That's better. That's a good idea, Scarlett.
Yeah, there was a couple boys, but they
were
early.
Yeah, perfect.
Just one more. Use the hair. And then just take it and put it in the barrel.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Think of good wishes for the plant's health and happiness. It makes a difference. They've done studies that prove.
Yeah, well, also that we're talking.
Yes, that we're talking
to it. We're talking about it. Yes.
plants like that too.
They like the love.
They like the love.
They were making a raspberry hole. Let's do it, guys.
All right, so this is a good spot. Just kind of stay on the side and then dig a nice big hole and put the soil right there.
Okay.
And let's get these raspberries out.
What are you guys digging? A raspberry hole.
Oh, okay.
No,
there's one here started already. You guys want to continue it?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Right, that's the one basically ready to go. They need to just put the good soil in it. Our neighbor just brought these here for us.
When are you closing?
These raspberry bushes. When it's dark.
Okay.
So there we go. And be careful because raspberries are a little bit thorny. I'll untangle them for you and then I'll let you plant them in the soil. Okay, so let's see. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. We can use this fence to lean them on for now. When the fence is gone, we'll get some stakes. Okay, so maybe dig a little tiny bit deeper, and then we will plant them. Yeah, there we go. This one has a good, look at this root. This is a really, see how big this root is?
Okay, let me see.
You see that big root? This is what you want. You want the more roots, the better chance it has to live. So we'll plant this one in here too.
Where exactly?
Right in here. There you go, sweetie. So there you go. Okay, all right. So now we're ready for you to take that soil and very gently place it on the roots. Okay?
That's a gigantic hole.
How big is that?
Right. 100 big holes.
No, 200.
You're being so delicate the way that you're shoveling that. That's very good work.
Really being 800. Yeah, this is actually part of the root, so we can actually bury that in the soil. Might even want to dig a little trench for it and stick it right down in there.
Okay, now we're going to put good soil there, okay? Okay.
Beautiful. It looks like if we're lucky, we might even get some raspberries later in the season. We can find another hole. Maybe right where you're standing.
Okay, this hole
right
is
there.
Ready.
Yay, that hole's ready. Okay.
But it has soil in it.
Soil is good for it. Yes, that's good, happy soil. Did you go?
I don't know where I should get.
Oh, you should probably go over there. Help right now with that one. They're doing it right now. Right this second. They're going to need... No, bring your shovel. Bring the little shovel.
Oh, wait, that is so beautiful. Oh. Look, we made this birdhouse for our garden.
Yeah, we've made it.
Thank you so much. We have to find a good spot.
Yeah.
Maybe you and your mom can find a good spot to hang it, and then we'll put some sunflower seeds in it. I think, you know what, we could actually probably use the rope that we just were given these raspberries.
Tristan's got it, so you want to stand on the other side of him there, and you can dig another hole kind of next to him.
I want to dig a different hole somewhere.
You want to dig a different hole?
Yeah.
Okay.
Come on in, the garden's open. It's now the second anniversary of Siempre Verde Garden and it's thriving. Art and green and community are all growing together here and it's really been fabulous for everybody. You know, we're just down the street from Children's Magical Garden in similar situation in that there's three lots, one of which is privately owned and contested. One of the differences is that we have, we don't have a corner lot here, and we're a little less visible in some regards. This space has been neglected for so many years and people stop looking at it, and now when they look, they're thrilled.
So I was here the other day,
sitting on this bench. Did I tell you this story?
No.
And it was raining, but I couldn't feel it. It was raining so lightly, but I could hear it because the leaves were all making the sound echo from the ivy. And it was just really kind of magical. And you don't have feelings like that sometimes in New York. They're very hard to come by, this connection, a little bit of connection to nature. It's very nice.
I've been in the garden since the sixth grade.
I'm in 12th grade right now, so I'm 17. I can't imagine myself without the garden, and I just can't imagine what somebody wants to do with a piece of land that the community has created. And it's just kind of heartbreaking.
What I like about the garden is the seesaw and the swing and the trees. I like that the garden has like a lot of life and things to play with, and it makes it very fun to be here. I also think that there shouldn't be another building here because I think there's enough buildings around this area.
I like the garden because it's special to me.
I feel like this garden is a positive thing for the community. People come in, they enjoy themselves.
Hello! We are planting a bulb to make this garden look prettier.
They talk with each other, meet new people.
Now, Ella, nice to meet you.
Oh, yeah.
They get together. Usually people in the community is hard because over here people don't really like interact and stuff. And then they see this beautiful garden, they come in and sit down and they're like, oh, hey, my name is this and that. And then they just start like mingling.
I was here since I was 16, had my child, who is now 21 and graduating from college, who had the opportunity to experience growing up and having fun in this garden, you know, and learning with the garden, you know. I mean, even the neighbors and that actually kept this garden, you know, well maintained, you know, it was like we were all just a family. They treated the kids as if they were their own. You know, my daughter actually went to PS20, which was, you know, convenient across the street, you know. We know that our kids are safe because we all know each other here. They had the chance to have fun and learn things and, you know, had enough space to explore and exercise, you know, and not just be home watching TV or whatever the case may be. You know, they had that chance to actually come out and have a childhood within this community and the garden.
Fresh lemonade, $2 only.
Would you like a delicious homemade lemonade, limeade, or peach iced tea? And this peach iced tea is made with peaches grown in our very own community garden. And all the proceeds from this lemonade sale goes to the Children's Magical Garden.
Good wishes for the plants' health and happiness. It makes a difference.
Look. Hey, we have to dig.